I was born in Patterson, California, literally in the town because my mother could not make it to Modesto to deliver me. So I was born at home. The first 5 years of my life was in the town of Patterson. There probably were 400 people there, maybe four blocks. Everybody knew you, which could be good and which could be bad. My dad was in the Navy. He met my mom. She was from New Orleans. And they got married. And then when my grandfather was killed, my dad moved to Patterson because he was the oldest of 10 children to help his mother. And my grandfather had been killed in a car accident in 1930. So that's how they ended up in Patterson. I was born near the end of the Depression, and we were very poor. We were really poor. And we moved from Patterson to Modesto when I was 5 years old. So we moved here in 1940, just before the war broke out. And we bought this, my mom and dad bought this house. It was on 327 Spruce Street. It was on the corner of Spruce and Franklin, which Franklin now is Martin Luther King Boulevard. That was the end of the Modesto city limits. So we had this little house that we lived in, two bedrooms, one bath, and there were eight of us. When I was 10 years old, I cut fruit. That's how I earned some money. Two different places. One was on Oakdale Road. At that time, there was a farm. And then on Mays Boulevard, cut fruit, peaches and apricots. I went to Washington Grammar School, which no longer exists. They tore it down. Now it is part of Modesto High School. Then I went on to Roosevelt Junior High. When I was at Roosevelt Junior High, I ran for Yale leader and got it. So when I went to Modesto High School in 1949, I decided I wanted to run for Yale leader. There were no female Yale leaders in the conference because they were called Yale leaders. They weren't cheerleaders. They were Yale leaders because they did very simple little yells in a megaphone, like lean to the left, lean to the right, stand up, sit down, fight, fight, fight. I mean, they were really simple things. And there were guys. There were no females because the females were pom-pom. They did the dances. Pom-pom girls and yell leaders. That was it. They call them cheerleaders, but they were called yell leaders in my day.
The yell leaders were more the ones who did cheers and got the crowd going.
Well, I didn't want to be a pom-pom. I wanted to be a yell leader because I had the voice to go with it. So I ran my junior year and didn't make it. So I ran, there was a fall and a spring. So I ran for fall, which was during football season. And there were three of us that ran. Well, I got more votes than the other two. And the school said, we have to have a runoff. So we did, and I lost. So then I ran for the spring, and I got 95% of the vote, and ended up being the first ever female yell leader at Modesto High and in the conference. As far as I know, no one ever took a picture of me in my cheerleading outfit. They just put a picture of me in the yearbook of my face. And then I made up a yell, and they use it till this day, and it goes M-O-D-E-S-T-O, Modesto, 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 and they still use that cheer. That's the one I made up. That my senior year, when I turned 18, I worked at the Camry, and I worked at Sears at the same time, and I was able to save almost $500, which doesn't sound like very much, but that got me through college. A gal that I went to school with, she said, well, Jenny, I'm going into the nursing program, and you get your room and board paid for. And I thought, oh, wow, that sounds like a good deal. So that's the only place I applied. I applied at San Jose State School of Nursing, which if you get into school of nursing, you all automatically get into San Jose State. So anyhow, I went to San Jose State and San Jose School of Nursing, and that was 3 years. I probably could have been a better student than what I was, but I was okay. I was an okay student.
After graduating from San Jose State, Jenny began her career as a nurse in 1956.
When I graduated, my first job was at San Luis Obispo with two of my classmates. It was called Mountain View Hospital in San Luis Obispo. It was a house that had been converted into a hospital. Back in 1956, when I graduated from college, you had three things that you used to diagnose your patient. One of them was a stethoscope, one of them was your hands, and one of them was your eyes. They didn't have monitors. They had nothing like that. You were the monitor. And so you got really used to looking for anything unusual in the patient. I was there for just about a year when my oldest sister got very, very ill. And I worked at Santa Clara County Hospital. I worked from there in the operating room from 57 to 59. And then I worked at San Jose County Hospital, and I worked everywhere. I did the emergency room, I did OB, medical, surgical, everything.
My entire life growing up, my mom worked full time. Full time, full time. She was in a very high pressure, important job.
And then from 1985 to 2004, I worked at Doctors Medical Center in the operating room.
In 1972, Jenny, who was a mother of five, raised safety concerns about nearby canals and started a petition.
At Franklin Grammar School on Mays, there was a canal that runs right by the school, and it was opened. It was just wide open. I thought, you know what, I'm going to try to do something.
She petitioned to have the canals covered so that children would not swim in the canals or be tempted to swim in them.
She wanted to be able to find a way to protect the children in Modesto from possibly drowning.
I had put out a petition and ended up with almost 800 signatures. And I put it in an envelope and sent it to the MID board. So I got a call from Matt Fiscalini, and he called me up and said, you know, we got your petitions and we can't afford that. He said, but we can fence them off. Would that satisfy you? I said, yeah, because anything to keep the kids away from. So then the canals were anywhere near a school or anywhere were fenced.
And I'm sure she saved a lot of lives doing that.
Then it was for a woman that was a full-time surgical nurse and raising five kids with my father, that tells you how much dedication she has when she wants to work on a project.
Which was funny because, once again, I was told by my friends and my husband, you're just wasting your time. And I go, nah, I don't think so. So anyhow, I got it done.
After Jenny's retirement from nursing, she became a tireless advocate for seniors across the San Joaquin Valley.
And Catholic Charities in 2008 asked me to come work for them in a program called Golden Ages for Progress. It was GAP. It was a senior thing. The main thing we wanted at that time was transportation for people who were homebound. And I knew that there was a lack of transportation for people with disabilities and seniors, and they were homebound. We did a survey and we found that there were 5,000 homebound people, not just seniors. So for 2 years, I went to STANCOG meetings.
She would come to our policy board meetings that met once a month, the third Wednesday of each month at 6 p.m. Rain or shine, there came Ms. Kenoyer. Some of the gaps that she found was that people felt, okay, you do have transit. You have the dollar ride that helps people with seniors or people with disabilities that can't really walk to the bus stop. Well, there was more to that. And she kept coming to the policy board. She knew that this was the platform that funded transit and that there was an opportunity to fund a service for the seniors that she was talking about.
It was clear that even at her age then, which was 72, that she was a very, she was a force and a force to be reckoned with.
By 2010, the board approved $100,000 to go to a pilot program that would help support homebound seniors to provide door-through-door services. The voters were so happy with the program that we started in 2010 that for 25 years now, thanks to Measure L, that program will exist for the seniors. The door-through-door will continue on for 25 years.
So we formed our own nonprofit, which is called MOVE, here in Stanislaus County. Our budget this year was a little under $2 million. So it went from $100,000 to $2 million.
Her advocating, coming every month to the policy board meetings, talking to the board members, helped get this program on board. And we couldn't have done it without her.
Jenny was at every one of those meetings, just an absolute advocate for the senior community, senior transportation. And she was tenacious, and there was no way of telling her no.
I think she just found a cause that she wanted to back, and you know, she did what she could to be a spokesperson for that cause. She was an effective advocate.
After Jenny's time as a community advocate, she began looking for new ways to serve.
Kristen Olson, she ran for the assembly and she won, and that left 3 years of the council District 5 seat open. And so they said, anybody can put your name in. And I thought, there were 13 of us. And I thought, well, I'll just throw my name in, see what happens. I figured I wouldn't get picked, and Stephanie Birdside got picked to finish out 1 year.
Our final conclusion and unanimous decision is to recommend Stephanie Burnside represent District 5.
So I am looking forward to working with everybody and, you know, moving forward and taking this community to a new level.
2011 was an election for 2 years. So I ran, and another young man that ran, and Stephanie.
When Jenny decided to run in 2011, you know, that was a little surprising to me, because I didn't think that someone that mature, shall we say, was going to be that interested in something that would be so demanding. Because the city council is demanding. It requires a lot of work and a lot of time. But I guess she really wanted to serve, and you know, so she went for it.
I lost to her that year. And I said to my kids, you know, if I had won, I would have to go to council meetings. So I decided that I was going to go to council meetings just like if I had won. So I went to every council meeting, every committee meeting, every ribbon cutting, anything that I would have done as a city council person.
2 years after her 30-point defeat to Councilwoman Burnside, Jenny decided to challenge her once again.
After I lost the election in 2011, I went to a party at Don Langman's house. And that's where I met Chad Condit. Just started talking, and I think he just got interested in my story. And then when I decided to run in 2013, he said he would help me.
Me and my father, Chad, helped Jenny in her second run for city council. Very informative for me, and a great experience to work with Jenny.
We were so lucky that he was willing to take a chance on Jenny. He was the one who had all of the knowledge regarding this industry that we did not have.
He helped in you know, putting together the flyer and the mailer, and knowing how to do that, and knowing what a precinct was. And I didn't know any of that when I ran in 2011.
And he saw that she could win and helped. And we're always indebted to him.
Sure enough, Jenny showed up again and wanted to run. And I think a lot of people said, you know, to unseat a rather popular, very effective, in my opinion, sitting councilwoman was going to be next to impossible.
She thought, because she was the incumbent, and she had everybody endorsed her. I had no endorsements except Democratic Party and a union, no one else.
The power of incumbency is huge. I think it was generally assumed that Stephanie would win.
People like Cecil Russell, Ray Simon, they said, you're wasting your time. You're not gonna win. It's a waste of time. They thought it was because of my lack of being in politics and also because I was running against an incumbent. In fact, I think that they were hoping that after this next term, that she would be the next mayor of the city of Modesto. They were priming her for that.
Mayor or supervisor, I think, yeah, she was on an upward mobility motion.
In 3 years, she was being known regionally because she was involved in some, projects and efforts that were more regional in nature.
I knew that there was only one way I could win, and that would be to knock on every door of every registered voter in my district. And that sounded pretty easy until I looked at there were 32 precincts. And it seemed like a daunting task at first, and I'm 78 years old. But I'm still a runner and a walker, so I started precinct by precinct and just clicking them off and clicking them off.
On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends.
I just got fewer and fewer, and, I did more and more. And finally, it was the end of October, couple of weeks before, I had done them all.
We kind of knew from polling and Chad being so on it that she had a chance.
Perhaps she was a little slow to recognize the power that Jenny was building by going door to door and meeting everybody that she could.
Okay, that brings us to item number one on the agenda, certification of canvass of votes from the November 5th, 2013 election.
District 5, Jenny Ketchum-Kenoyer, 2,580 votes, 51.25%.
When Jenny beat Stephanie Burnside, I honestly was surprised. I don't know what Stephanie thought, but it did appear that she probably underestimated what Jenny was willing to do to get voters to vote for her.
Some say when one door closes, another one opens. And I'm a huge believer in things happen for a reason. Although I am leaving this council seat sooner than I would have liked, it does not in any way define me, nor will it waver my dedication to the city. There are still great things that need to be done in this community, and I promise the city of Modesto has not seen or heard the last of me yet.
I don't want to talk about regrets for people, but I bet she would step back and go, I wish I had taken that little lady more seriously because I didn't know what I was up against. And no one does when it comes to Jenny. That's the thing. Nobody knows what they're gonna get when they come up against her.
I do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States, that I will bear true faith and allegiance without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, discharge the duties upon which I'm about to enter. Congratulations.
I mean, Stephanie still raised more money than Jenny, actually a lot more. And, Jenny just out-hustled Stephanie.
She didn't win by much, but it was a shocker. I'm going to say it was probably one of the biggest upsets that there's been in Modesto politics.
Chad was a great help. Without him, that would have never happened. And that makes a big difference. And I must say that Cooper took some pictures, and so kind of like the whole family, yes. It's been a wonderful experience.
Just months into her term on the Modesto City Council, citizens located in Wood Colony began campaigning for the recall of Councilmember Kenoyer.
I think it was maybe my third or fourth council meeting, and we were looking at amending our general plan. And Wood Colony, in this new formation of the map, they had included Wood Colony.
Wood Colony is a specific area that's outside of Modesto city limits. There's a lot of heritage that's in that area, a lot of farming that goes on in that area.
What we were doing at Wood Colony was already in our former general plan. They thought we were trying to annex them into the city. We can't annex if they want to have a vote. And if they have a vote and it gets turned down, it never ever happens. We can't override that vote as a city. And we actually even came forward with the idea to make it an ag designation within the city's general plan.
Every meeting got bigger and bigger.
Wood Colony has been here for over 100 years, and it would be a tragedy if the city council members of Modesto would want this action to pass.
Wood Colony is more than just a series of contiguous acreage.
Wood Colony is not a community in need of your fixing. Attempting to annex an area in the name of creating jobs, whilst we have one of the best examples in this city for creating jobs, is downright insulting.
I'm here to tell you that as for Salida, Wood Colony, and your neighbors on the west side, you wouldn't get elected to the office of dog catcher if you vote against us.
Seizing private property.
We're not seizing
is
anything.
The same thing. That's essentially what I believe that you're trying to do here.
This is really not what Modesto needs. Please reconsider this annexation. Thank you.
I hope you listen to this community.
It just got huge.
I don't know if there's a saying or not, but I've heard it say there's a saying in politics, which is never underestimate the power of a packed room. Nevertheless, that power never seemed to sway or dare I say scare Jenny.
I just remember being very contentious. A lot of contentious council meetings, a lot of back and forth.
Jenny Kenoyer came out of this stand up here and came to this stand and literally attacked me because of what I said. And not one of you had the guts, I could say something else but I won't, to come down and stop her. Aren't you ashamed?
Martha, I think that you need to stand here. And let me explain, I did not, you know why I came down there? Was because you trespassed on my property. You came across, listen to me now, I listen to you. I live in a guarded community. Listen to me, please. I listen to you.
So Jenny was pretty new on the council when this came forward. She hadn't learned to accept criticism without responding.
They were taking pictures of her. She just grabbed her picture camera and started taking pictures of them. And oh, there was a gasp in the audience.
Councilmember Kenoyer.
I was taking pictures because my picture's taken so much, I thought I should have an opportunity to take your pictures. Because mine, you know, you take my pictures all the time, and I don't know why anybody should be really upset with that.
And the whole updating of the general plan was a learning curve area for her.
As a brand new council member, being very naive, they zeroed in on me. Every meeting it was like, you know, Kenoyer's a liar, you know, we need to get rid of, recall Kenoyer, and then all of a sudden shirts showed up and signs showed up. Now they also said that Dave Cogdell needed to be recalled, but he didn't have shirts for him, they didn't call him a liar, he didn't have signs.
I thought it was a joke, actually. I thought it was foolhardy. I think it was absolutely personal against both of those two people. And from them responding back, you know, and it's just something that Jenny wasn't ready for it. Dave wasn't willing to accept it either.
The recall, when Jenny was threatened with recall, she stared it down and nothing came of it.
I remember when they were starting the recall process, I've never felt that recalls just generally serve any purpose. That's what elections are for. But she held her head high, did what she was supposed to, and squashed it.
You know, they tried to get signatures and they couldn't. They didn't get enough signatures and it just died.
Since being elected to the Modesto City Council in 2013, Jenny was elected to another term in 2017. Jenny is set to term out in 2022.
Modesto City Council District 5, Jenny Kenoyer, 3,011 votes, 65.07% of the vote. And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
I want to thank District 5 voters for allowing me to represent them on the Modesto City Council for the next 4 years. And I do want to thank my campaign staff that was very small and has always been my daughter and son-in-law. And also Chad Condit, I don't know if he's here, but anyhow, that was my entire campaign team. They've been with me for 3 years and they said, Mom, this is it. I'm terming out, yes. I'll be terming, I'll be 9 years. And it's been a wonderful 9 years, great 9 years. I'll be 87 when I term out. And that, yeah, it's time. Some of the things that I've accomplished on the 8 years that I've been on City Council. Highway 132, which was been on the drawing board for well over 60 years. We pushed really hard and I was very vocal about we needed to get it done, and so we are. It's in the process, a lot of people see.
The State Route 132 was a project that sat there for 60 years, and she sat on this board, and together they made this project a priority, and it's underway right now.
The 7th Street Bridge is something that I have really been concerned with. I have asked Stancock to put it on a priority list now to really get it done, because it's just a hazard and it's just a matter of time that it might come down. And since we know it's bad, it's the second worst bridge in California. So that's something I have been very vocal on trying to get done. Tony Madrigal and I have been trying to get Merced to bring a extension to Modesto. And so I'll just keep working. That's one of the big things I'm gonna work on the next year and a half that I have left here. I was really concerned in was people experiencing homelessness.
One of the big issues for Jenny has always been homelessness. She's had great ideas of things that we can do to help solve homelessness, because she just has such a big heart for people and wanting to see people, you know, rise up. We added 183 low barrier shelter beds on the north side of the shelter. We put the access center, which was also one of Jenny's big pushes, is where do people go to get access to services?
Maybe help you get your Social Security, help you get your driver, your ID. That's the Access Center.
And so we put the Access Center right there on the same block.
And Jenny was very instrumental in that. And she was persistent. She was somebody that was a staunch advocate, I would say.
And she was a lead on that. She was also on several committees that helped out on the homelessness.
Jenny's legacy to Modesto is a servant's heart. It's somebody that has served as a nurse in her profession. She's a servant of the people in elected office, or even if she's not in elected office.
You know, she'll tell you about her being the first cheerleader of Modesto High, and you know, she's, you know, lived the majority of her life here, and she really truly cares for this community.
A very, very sharp, intelligent person that will let you know that she was a nurse and let you know she went to Modesto High and she was one of the Yale leaders or cheerleaders. And those are just great characteristics of a Modestan.
So when she was at Modesto High, she came up with a cheer and they did that. It was a Modesto cheer. So at this meeting, she talked about it and the whole audience did it with her. It was great.
Okay, let's go.
loves Modesto. She loves Modesto. She'll do anything for the betterment of the city.
I feel that Jenny has Modesto running, you know, through her veins, and it's in her blood.
She loves the city. She absolutely loves her constituents in the city, and she loves being on council.
From Assembly District 12, Jenny Kenoyer, escorted by Assemblymember Flora. Councilmember Jenny Kenoyer is a lifelong resident of Modesto and retired after 48 years as a registered nurse. She has 5 children and 8 grandchildren. She has been active in several community organizations, including the Stanislaus County Commission on Aging, Senior Elder Abuse Prevention Alliance, American Allegiant Auxiliary, and the Lazarus Ministry.
So working with Jenny, I will tell you, age is just a number. Because Jenny Kenoyer, at 86 years old, is sharp as a tack, and she knows exactly what she's talking about. You can't fool her, so don't try.
Jenny inspires me as a person, as a woman. She inspires many women, many people, and I'm not just saying women, but people, all people, because of her positive attitude.
Very involved in the community, when she had 5 kids, was raising 5 kids, she was always involved in the community, both her and my dad were.
She made all of our costumes for Halloween. She made all my prom dresses from scratch, 1 wedding dress. She was the mom who wanted to do it all. And in some ways, I don't want to cry, it's so dumb. It's not possible to do it all. But she tried and she did it. And she made the costumes, and she went to the activities, and she went to all the sporting events, and she worked full time.
Again, her legacy is going to be that no one loved her community more than she does. She's a true champion for the people of Modesto.
And I think her legacy is a legacy of public service, service to Modesto and to her community and her fellow man.
And so her legacy is, you're never too old to do something for your community.
I think part of her legacy is going to be the transformation that's been made in the transportation system here in the city.
I think she should be remembered for her passion and work ethic for the city of Modesto. Just make sure that we were growing and improving every day.
For me, Jenny Kenoyer will always be somebody that I feel that I had the privilege to learn from and the honor to serve with.
I feel very humble. I don't personally, and take this the way you are, I don't think I've done anything special. I think anybody could do what I do if you just want to take the time. I've had an incredible life. There's a lot of, you know, sadness and trauma, and I survived cancer, which I'm not even supposed to be here right now. But I look at, if I measure the good against the sad, so much more good. And I feel so blessed that I've been given this opportunity, this kind of life. It seems like, you know, I did little things along the way. To me, were just little things that I did because they needed to be done. And I think that's part of how I got where I am. I saw a need to be done, and I felt like I was the person that could get it done. It's been an incredible journey. My whole life has been an incredible journey. I think that if you really believe that you want to see an improvement in how you live, how your community lives, you have to be part of it. And anybody can be part of it.
One day I decided I'm going to start taking the stairs. I park on the basement. I had to take a break on the 4th floor. And here comes Jenny. She laps me in the stairwell, and I have to live with that every day.
When the DJ opened up the floor for people to start doing the bhangra, which is a traditional Indian dance, Jenny Kenoyer was one of the first ones to get up there.